are we doing for?
This will be fine. We're going to do some music, talk about a fictional programming language I invented, turn it into a real one, build a recursive descent parser, show you how to implement a parsing expression grammar, play some more music, and it'll be wrapped up in time for Mina to finish out today and get to the party. Sound good to you? Yes. Let's go.
Thank you.
CityJS. So, my name is Dylan, and I'm here today how to tell all of you how to be Rockstar developers. Now, I'm sure you are familiar with the trope of the Rockstar developer. You go on LinkedIn or IT Jobs and you search for Rockstar, and you will find people looking for a Rockstar junior web developer. You'll find Rockstar senior front-end developer, Rockstar JavaScript and Node.js, Rockstar senior Java software developer. And a few years back, somebody had the brilliant idea, which they put on Twitter, to really confuse recruiters, someone should make a programming language called Rockstar. My response to this is in the form of a GIF. Challenge accepted. Friends, I would like to introduce you to Rockstar, a dynamically typed Turing-complete programming language designed for creating computer programs that are also song lyrics, heavily influenced by the lyrical conventions of 1980s hard rock and power ballads. It's basically a compiler for meatloaf songs, right? Give you a quick heads up on the syntax. So, hello world in Rockstar, it's got to be easy, because, you know, musicians are not noted for their intellect. So, you want to say hello world, you say hello world. But maybe you don't want to say that day. Maybe you want to scream, or you want to whisper hello world, or you want to shout hello world. Now, to build programming languages, we need to be able to do variables and assignment. And, you know, in most languages, int x equals 5, semicolon, var my underscore string, what's the underscore, equals hello world, the message equals city.js rocks. Now, we're dynamically typed. We don't care about int and var and all this kind of stuff. And the semicolons, Ruby doesn't need them, so Perl doesn't need them. We can live without those. Now, x equals 5. Equals looks a little bit like maths, and most of the great rock and rollers I know skipped maths. So we need something a little bit more accessible. We need is. X is 5. My string is hello world. The message is city.js rocks. Now, my underscore string and the message with the weird Pascal casing. I saw Douglas Crockford give a talk a few years ago where he said, how many of you have had an argument like longer than 3 hours with your team about whether to use kebab casing or Pascal casing or snake chainsaw underscore left-hand bracket casing? And you're like, yeah. He's like, what we want are variable names with spaces in it. Now, Rockstar was invented in a bar as a joke. And when you invent languages in a bar as a joke, you can do anything you want. And so I said, all right, we're going to have variable names with spaces in them. It wasn't a complete free-for-all. There are three kinds of variables in Rockstar. There are simple variables, which work like they do in most dynamic languages. It's just a name that doesn't already mean something else. There are common variables, which have to have a prefix. My heart, an ocean, your dream, a kiss, the night. And proper variables have capital letters. So Dr. Feelgood, Black Betty, and Billie Jean are all valid identifiers. Now, most programming involves a lot of numbers. And other than that awful Billy Ray Cyrus song about the phone number, there's not that many numbers in rock and roll. So I needed a way of initializing variables with numeric values that didn't involve putting literals in. And I thought, what if we take the words on a line of code, and if we start it with variable is something, we count the lengths of the words modulo 10 and treat those as decimal digits. So we can initialize fizz is ice, 3, Buzz is dying, that's 5. The limit is a love-struck lady killer, 100, that's 3, 5, and 100. We are on our way to FizzBuzz in Rockstar, which is important, because if you can't do FizzBuzz, you can't do interviews. And if you can't do interviews, you can't get the Rockstar programmer jobs, right? Arithmetic. Now, in normal, everyday English maths, the total equals price plus tax. But actually, if you're just telling me, how much is the total? It's the price with the tax. So we can use that. We can say, well, arithmetic expressions, the price with the tax, the total without the tax, the quantity of the product, the distance over the time, this all makes perfect sense. But we can also say, a girl with a dream, a man without a face, the wings of the night, a whisper over the water. We need comparison operators so we can do loops and conditions and things. We have, your love is a lie, the whiskey ain't the answer. My heart is stronger than steel, my soul is weaker than water, my will is as strong as a lion, and your lies are as low as a snake. We have arithmetic, we have comparisons, we have Boolean operators. We need functions. Now, if you tell somebody how a function works, you'll say something like, well, okay, the maximum function, it takes x and y, and if x is greater than y, it'll give back x, otherwise it'll give back y. So basically, that is the function syntax. We have a, for example, arithmetic modulus takes a number and a divisor. And while a number is as high as a divisor, this is how you do modulus with repeated subtraction, while a number is as high as a divisor, put the number without the divisor into the number, and then give back the number, and then this blank line you can see here, that terminates the loop. That's the end of a block statement. So we can also write modulus like this. Midnight takes your heart and your soul. And while your heart is as high as your soul, you put your heart without your soul into your heart and give back your heart. This is FizzBuzz in Rockstar. We're going to come back to that because we're a little pressed for time. Trust me, you will see it before this is out. Now, does anybody recognize this fine gentleman here? This is Joe Satriani, because here today, JS means JavaScript, but out there in the wonderful world of rock and roll, JS means Joe Satriani. And so when I finally sat down and decided to write an interpreter for the language I invented in a bar as a joke, I thought Satriani would be a good name for the project because it has this nice JS rock and roll connection. Now, we're going to talk about how you build an interpreter for a little snippet of code that looks like this. I'm going to do it in a couple of stages. First, we are going to talk about how does an interpreter actually work? We got a bunch of source code, and we want to turn that into a program, run the program, and see what the result of that program is. There are kind of three ways you can do this. We've got our input file here, fizzbuzz.rock, and we can run it through a transpiler, which takes Rockstar, which nobody knows about, and translates it into something like JavaScript, or Python, or Ruby, or Scala, which somebody actually did. And that we can then run it, because we know how to run JavaScript, or Ruby, or Python, or Scala. Apparently some people run that. We can run it through a compiler that takes FizzBuzz code and turns it into a binary executable that talks to the machine in raw machine language and gives us back an executable, and when we run that, we get the output. Or we can build an interpreter, which is another program that takes this program and tells us what that program does. The point is, all three of these techniques will yield the same output. They are all different ways of doing the same thing. I decided to build an interpreter. I didn't want to build a transpiler because that kind of just means translating your language into someone else's, and where's the fun in that? And I didn't want to build a compiler because that actually looks really difficult. So I decided I was going to build an interpreter for Rockstar. Now, the way most interpreters work is you put your code in, it runs it through the interpreter, that gives you some output, and so you type Rockstar, hello world.rock, and it says hello world. And the way it does this under the hood is it takes your source file and it parses it. And the output of the parser is a thing called an abstract syntax tree, which is like it's your program distilled of all the junk and purified into raw semantic meaning. And then you take the abstract syntax tree and you feed that into the interpreter, and that kind of crunches through it and it goes, all right, we'll do this, fine, I think I know what's going on here, output. Now then, abstract syntax trees in JavaScript. The reason I say in JavaScript, abstract syntax trees are easy to write in strongly typed languages because you have a binary node and you have an output node and you have this node. And what do we have in JavaScript? Object, number, string, Boolean, function, and sometimes they change types when you're not looking and you weren't quite sure what happened with it. So if we have the number 23, the parse tree for that is number 23. That's a number, it's the number 23. If we have arithmetic expressions, 23 plus 45 divided by 2, sorry, 23 plus 45, that is a binary node. It's an addition node with a left-hand side and a right-hand side. And the left-hand side is number 23, and the right-hand side is number 45. If we have this, 23 plus 45 divided by 2. You know those things that do the rounds on Facebook with, like, you know, you got to say a witch plus a frog multiplied by a spoon equals 12, what's the value of Boris Johnson, and all your school friends argue about it for like 1 million comments. This is how real grown-ups do operator precedence. You build it into the order in which your parsing tree consumes operators. So this thing is an addition statement, and it adds the number 23 plus a divide statement, which has a left-hand side with 45, and a right-hand side, which is 2. If we rewrite that expression and we move the divide sign, we get a different tree. Now it's an addition, and the left-hand side of the addition is a divide expression with 45 and 2, and the right-hand side here is 23. And if we stick a minus 9 on the end of that, now we have a binary addition, which has a 23, and a binary subtraction, which is a binary division. And you see the way it grows quite gracefully. As your expressions get more complicated, your parse tree just like, oh yeah, well, I'll tuck this lot under here and put that on the left-hand side. And I'll tuck this lot and put that on the right-hand side, and that's all absolutely fine. So if we take our little snippet of Rockstar code here, the night was wild and stormy. That is going to be a variable called the night with a declaration. It's an assignment to the value 436. So that's going to look like this. Assign the variable the night to the number 436. The wind was howling free. Well, now we have two statements in a row. We need some kind of list. So the abstract syntax tree actually becomes a list with multiple nodes in it in order that will be interpreted in order. Assign the wind to the number 74. Let the dawn be the wind over the night. That is an assignment of a variable to a binary division expression, because over is, you know, x over y. That's how we divide in Rockstar. Binary operator division, lookup on the left, and that's now a variable lookup. It's not a value, it's a lookup. It says, go and find that in your environment somewhere, because we put a value in there, and we gave it a name. Go and retrieve that value, divide that value by this value, bubble that back up the tree, whisper the dawn. That is an output node. It outputs a lookup value, and the lookup is the dawn. Now, this is what it looks like conceptually. We need a way of representing this in JavaScript. So what I did is I just used a key. I did the whole thing as a big JavaScript object, like a JSON-style literal. But each node is keyed by a string, and the string denotes what kind of node that is in the syntax tree that is being used for that part of the language. Right, we are going to be ambitious now, because we are going to do a live demo, and we are going to implement a parser for one tiny subset of the Rockstar language. We're going to implement a parser that can do a series of those poetic literals we talked about. Now, the tool that I used to build all this is this thing. This is PEG.js. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to open up. PEG.js is a node package that lets you build a thing called a parsing expression grammar in JavaScript. And I'm going to go to PEG.js.org, because they have a wonderful kind of online playground that lets you put in your grammar over here and your language over here, and it'll tell you if it worked, and it'll build a parser for you, and then you can download that parser and embed that into your project. Bear with me one second while I dig out my crib sheet here. While we're doing all that, try PEG.js online. Let me blow that up full screen. Ooh. No? How do Macs work? Can anyone remember? Joe was the only person today demonstrating on Windows. I should have done this on Windows. I've been at home on Windows for 18 months, and the Mac is the road laptop, and I've forgotten how it works. Okay, let me crank that up a little bit. So basically, the way a grammar works is you have to define a bunch of symbols, and you say, this symbol, when this happens, it'll be represented, you'll find this pattern. So look out for this pattern in your code. When you find that, that's one of these, and this is what it means. So, for example, we could build a very, very simple evaluator here for... There we go. All right. So, a couple of rules we need. First of all, we need white space. So the convention is you say, well, white space will just denote with an underscore. And the white space character in this language is, and it's based on regular expressions. So if you see a space or if you see a tab character, basically one or more of those, that's white space. We have an end of line, which is going to be a backslash r or a backslash n, one or more of those. And we have end of file, because at some point it needs to go, you've run out of program. And end of file means not, bang, dot. So if there is no character, not any more character, that is the end of the file. Now, what we want to do is build something that can compile these poetic literal statements that we talked about here. So I'm going to start out by saying that an assignment here in my language is going to be a variable is expression, variable operator expression. So the variable, then an underscore to denote some white space, and then is, and then that, and then expression. And if you look down here, saying rule variable is not defined. All right, so let's define variable. So we're going to say that a variable in Rockstar has to be a, so we got this thing of, you know, my face, your dream, whatever. It's a prefix followed by an identifier. So it's a prefix followed by some space, followed by identifier. And what we want to do, well, prefix here has to be, so we're going to say, well, this is going to be, so it can be a, and it's a I for case insensitive, or it can be an, I for case insensitive, or my, or your. Those are our valid prefixes, a, an, my, your. Let's put the in as well, that might be useful. I slash the. Okay, so now we've defined prefixes, we've defined the underscore identifier. What is that going to be? Well, we are actually going to define here, I'm going to crib this one because it's hard to type, because Rockstar variables are English letters plus any letter with an umlaut in it, because this is rock and roll. So this is the set of letters that we are going to support in, where has my, there it is. So, identifier is that set of characters. We need one or more of those. That gives us a valid identifier. Rule is not defined. So finally, we want to say is equals what are the keywords we can use for basically in the space of an equal sign. And those are going to be is slash was slash are slash were. Okay, expression is not defined. Well, for starters, we can say, let's put in something really simple. Let's say expression equals, let me check how we're doing here. Expression equals 5. So we can assign things to the value 5. That is a literal here. So that happens. There we go. Parser built successfully. We have a green light. And if we go over here and say my dreams is 5, we have forgotten to, what have we forgotten to do? No, that's fine. So we need to, in our variable rule here, we need to capture those things. We need to say the prefix, we're going to capture that inside something, and that's the ID. And when we find that, when we find that expression, we need to return something. Now, inside this little set of curly brackets here, we can write JavaScript code. This is just completely plain vanilla JavaScript code, so we want to return something. And what we want to return is an assignment node. And if we plug that in there, that's going to give us one of those. There we go. Okay, and return assignment. And an assignment here consists of, what are we assigning? Variable. So the variable here is going to be, I put this in the wrong place. Assignment is the line above. There we go. So that's going to be v variable is e expression. Assign variable is going to be v, and expression is going to be e. That should be fine. Line 6, column 1, that's there. OK. So assignment is that. We got a prefix. Takes an ID and an identifier. So if that happens, we want to return something. We need to return a token we use internally within the language to keep track of that variable. Now, under the hood, this is basically creating JavaScript objects. They can't have spaces in identifiers. So I'm going to give back a prefix plus a literal underscore character plus the identifier. And there we go. So why is this now complaining to us? It is complaining because, so this thing here is saying it's built the parser, but then the parser is saying expected a white space, but M found. Why is it found M? I know why it's found M. We have not told it anywhere that we are writing a program here. So we can say a program is a, well, what do we got here? We got assignment. Let's just write a thing because we're running a little short on time here. A program has to be an assignment. So we've got now my dreams is 5. We'll change that to my dreams are 5. Now you see this my DREAMS. That's because by default, the parser gives you back an array containing all the characters in the thing it found. Because it thinks that's what you want, right? That's not what we want. So we are going to go over here, and in our variable identifier here, we are going to say, let me just check the syntax for this one. So this thing needs to be ID $identify. I think if we put a string in there, there we go. So what we now have here is we put this program into that grammar, and we get out this little snippet of JavaScript here, this little parse tree. And the last thing that we are going to do is we are going to go and plug into this actually, no, we're not. We're going to put this on GitHub because I know they're going to kick us out, and we got more stuff coming. So, and we are going to finish today. I need 4 minutes and 11 seconds. So the problem with doing music and everything like this, they're always like, go, and then they're like, oh no, we can't find it. Oh, we have a different audio adapter. And it's like, you know, if you take 5 minutes to set up the audio for a 25-minute talk, you've seriously interrupted the flow of the thing. So, putting it all together. Let us jump back in over here. I will stick all this, the whole thing is open source. It's codewithrockstar.com/try it. Boom, 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 boom. There's a bunch of circular evaluators and that kind of stuff. There we go. That's the node package. That is the website where you can go and try it out. That is the stickers that I give out on the occasions when I don't leave them at home by mistake. And this is a live performance of FizzBuzz in Rockstar so that you can see for yourselves whether you think this is a legitimate programming language that allows you to write songs. If you have any questions, Mina's on now. I'm out of here. Thank you. That was a lot of fun.